in a short while, the men.
Jai Ram, Ram, Jai Ram.
Boliye Syapati Ram Chandra ki Jai. As I said, our topic, my topic this morning, all love is not equal. And I'm not taking it from a romantic novel. I'm taking it from Ramchandramanas. Ayodhya Kand, page 525. See, anything, any experience possible that a human being can experience, it is documented in one of the scriptures of Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma, it's ancient. It was relevant 100,000 years ago. It is relevant today. And it will be relevant in the next 100,000 years. According to Swami Vivekananda, everybody were Hindus, are Hindus, or will be Hindus, in spite of what is happening around the world. And Sanatana Dharma is the mother of all religions. It's the most ancient, it's the most relevant today, and it will always be relevant no matter what happens. वचन अगोचर बुद्धि पर राम स्वरूप तुम नेति नेति जैया गमरा अविगत अकर पारसिया पति राम चंद्र की जय जय सेटिंग्स इज इन द फॉरेस्ट Bhagwan Shri Ram left Ayodhya to fulfill one, the wish of his father's vachan, and two, to protect the righteous, and three, to keep the promises that he would have made to devotees from time to time, so that when he comes, when he manifests, and to walk on planet Earth, he would take his time and fulfill all those promises that he would have made to individual devotees. Bhagavad Gita says it differently. Yada yada hi dharmasya, chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. Luke 7 and 8. It's exactly. And whatever you read in Ramayana, you will see it in Bhagavad Gita, or you'll see it in Mahabharata, or you see Devi Bhagapuran. All the scriptures, they preach the same truth. And no matter what language, what style, wherever you are, and so long as you are preaching the truth, it can never change. The truth is always never changing. And here, this katha is called the Ram Balmiki Milad, where they met Sambad, where they met in the forest. And it's a beautiful conversation what triggered this situation. In that Ram was behaving in a certain way, and he was asking for guidance from this sage, this realized master. But this realized master knows who is Ram. And he's saying, Hey Raghunaji, aapka swarup aur vachan budhiman par hai, aapki gati apar hai, kahne mein nahi aati. Ved bhi nitya jisko neti neti kahte hai. O Ram, you have manifested. This manifestation that you have, it is beyond understanding. It is beyond understanding. The Vedas and all the scriptures in words cannot describe who you really are. And that's why, to make it easy, they just refer to you as Neti Neti Se. And we hear so many descriptions of what Neti Neti Se means in English language. Many, but it cannot, if all the scriptures in the world cannot describe this God, can Neti Neti Se really describe? Neti Neti Se means he's not this, he's not that, but he's everything. Upanishads use two beautiful examples. He says he's faster than the fastest, but he never moves. He's bigger than the biggest, but he's smaller than the smallest. How you could understand that? And I like to refer to Bhagavad Gita. Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Maruta Stunvanti Divyaistavai Vedai Sangha Padakramo Panishadai Gayanti Yam Samaga Dhyana Vastita Tadrate Namanasa Pashyanti Yam Yogino यस्यांतम नाविदु सुर सुर गना देवाये तस्मै नमः. That even the devatas and devis cannot understand this God. Religion try to understand. Religion claim him. My God is better than your God. I will kill you because you don't pray to God how I call him. So many crazy things is happening. But even if the angels and archangels do not understand this God, how? What else will happen? As soon as we learn to tie a little dhoti a little bit, we better than every pundit. As soon as we know a little bit of Hindi, we better than everybody else. How stupid. Stupid. Murkhai. Stupidity to the highest level. Because Gita Dhyan says, even the devatas and devis cannot understand this power called God. And you know what is nice again? In Uttarakhand, in that beautiful katha where Rama was addressing everybody, Bare bhagya manushyatana pawa, that it is so great just to be a human being that even the devatas and devis beg to get back a human body. Yeah? We want to go there and they want to come here. Something we're missing. We're missing something. If we want to go there and they want to come here, there is something special about us that they cannot achieve when they in heavenly planets. Because ye manushya shirir moksh ka dwara hai. When you're in heaven, you're not liberated. See, it's a total misguided concept. Oh, do this, do that, cook food every Sunday, make parasad, sarang for puja, put on all your jhandi every year, and you'll go to heaven. No. If a pundit tell you that, he's fooling you. I'm saying it again. If a pundit tell you that, he's fooling you. Because Hinduism, we don't teach people to go to heaven. We teach you to become liberated. Gati, upper varg. That is what we, to become liberated. And when you become liberated, you don't go to heaven. You don't go to heaven. If the limit in Republic Bank is $1 million to deposit at a time, you can't go there because we deposit in trillions of dollars at a time in with our devotion because we are going higher than that. We don't aspire for that. Because Sanatan Dharma, we do not teach you to go to heaven. Heaven is when you get a credit. You get about 75 or 80% mark. And definitely we don't teach you to go to hell. We might tell you go to hell, man, but we don't teach you to go to hell. Sanatan Dharma teach you how to get 100 marks. When you live this human life, you must achieve 100 marks. Because when you get 100 marks, you watch heaven and say goodbye. I might see my friends might be down there, but not me. I am transcending. I'm transcending the seven lower lokas and the seven upper lokas because we are being liberated where we merge with God. NASA has come across something beautiful recently. I like to bring science with religion. Then you will understand how perfect Sanatan Dharma is. They have recorded. Hubble have recorded way into the outer space. Anybody know about it? Let me see. How many of you heard about it? How many read about it? NASA put recordings way out in the galaxies through the Hubble. And you know, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God, and the Word is Om. That's NASA proved that now in 2015 that all the sound outside in the cosmos Om. How beautiful is Sanatan Dharma. So could we claim God? Do we know God? We look at some murtis and we think we know God. But if he come in a next form, which form God will come in? He has no form and he has every form. He has no hands and he has every hand. Like that we have to understand. So Valmiki say in here, Rama, you manifest like this, but words cannot describe you. The human mind cannot comprehend you. And if we go back to how God took form, in Satyug, in the early days in Sanatan Dharma, on the life of human beings, God was just sound. Om, universal sound. But it is very difficult for you and I to comprehend this Om. We will draw it Om, and you fit it in a paper, you fit it on a board, you fit it anywhere else. But to really understand the power of this Om, it's not possible. And to help people like you and I, He took avatar, he took manifestation, so that we will get something to work on, so that we can go towards our spiritual goal. And here, Valmiki is telling Rama that you, O Ram, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, puppets in your hand. You move them as you wish, according to your divine will. And he's saying that. But he's also given us some courage and consolation.
Sri Ram Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama. Sri Ram Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama.
Sri Ram Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama. Sri Ram Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama.
So janay jahi dehu janai, janat tumhe tum thi ho jai. Ta ur chandan
Sri Ram Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama Sri Ram Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama.
And Valmiki is saying, hey Prabhu, people pray to you. People make sacrifices. People do jap and tap and everything else in the world. But only when you shower your grace upon them, only then would they be able to get a glimpse of who you are. That's why in Sanatana Dharma, we tell you, you're going to read your book. You bow. Say your prayer. Om Sri Ganeshaya Namah, Om Saraswati Namah, your Guru Mantra, and then you start to study. You're going to do exams. We teach you. You sit by your paper, you utter your prayer, and you bow to your exam paper. That's Sanatana Dharma. Why you think Hindus are dominating in certain fields around the world? Because we teach you that surrender. Bhagavad Gita, again, Ved Vyas Maharaj talked about prostrating to even Bhagavad Gita, to Bhagavad Gita, to the writer, to the gurus, to everybody. And only then you would get some nectar from these scriptures. And Valmiki is reinforcing that. O Rama, only when you shower your grace. We hear punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. People go and come and go and come and go and come until, provided they persist and persevere, until the grace of God doesn't shower upon you, nothing could happen. Nothing could happen. And my topic this morning is, all love is not equal. I'm giving you an overview of this God we're talking about. Because Tulsidas describes Rama, keval pyara hai. All Rama is love. And this universe is filled with love. That's what it is. It is a world of love. If everything there is love, and God is love, and when he shower his grace upon us, we can experience it. Thing. Just to feel love inside of your heart is a divine thing. People describe it as all kind of thing, but to really feel love, I'm not talking about lust, infatuation, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the shade of emotion that is called love. Only when God bless you, you could experience that emotion that is called love. Because we are reveling in this something, this experience called human life. Bade bhagya se. very fortunate, very blessed. And Valmiki is saying, when the devotee, when you put, apply chandan to the middle of your forehead here, on your third eye, you are supposed to feel a beautiful coolness, a nice energy should permeate your body when it is done properly, when it is done with the right ingredient. We have many, many things that we call chandan today. I'm talking about chandan, real chandan, when it is applied. And the chandan wood is a protected species. You cannot cut that unless you have a permit to do that. Every year, plenty of people get locked up for stealing chandan wood, crossing the Himalayas to send it over to China and Tibet and these places. It is protected by law. But the thing about it is that that has special effect on the human body, so that when it is applied as tilak, your entire body experiences that. And Valmiki is using this example to talk about Rama as the chandan when applied, how it feels. So that feeling only comes by the grace of God. And Valmiki say, "Oh Ram, not because you're looking like a human being, you're laughing and talking like a human being, you're a human being." Says, in English we say, when you're in Rome, you do as the Romans. Valmiki used this example in. What most important thing that he said in here? Aap charit dekh sunkar murkh mohit aur pandit sukhi ho gaye. When a stupid person listens to the glories of God or sings the places of God, he becomes more stupid. And when a wise person listens to the glories of God and sings the glories of God or finds himself in a place where the glories of God is recited, he becomes ecstatic. His experience becomes at a higher level where he enjoys happiness, real happiness, everlasting happiness. We just get spurts of happiness. Huh? As soon as by the time the clock ticks 5 minutes, you're going back down to the old state. That is not real happiness. You just experience a little spurt of it. But to experience happiness, the devotee enjoys and revel in this all the time, even though when the neighbor quarreling at you. But you will experience it all the time. But this is the love that I'm talking about, that it is God-given. All love is God-given. And here, to conclude my message today, Suni Muni Vachana Prema Rasa Sane. The Muni, Valmiki Ji, was speaking to Bhagwan Ram, even when he challenged him, in Prema Rasa, in loving tones. And you would have heard in our mandir, we talk about the four ras. Anybody can remember them? Yeah? Four ras. When a vengeful person gets revenge, when a miser counts his money, when a lover meets his lover, and when a devotee experiences God. Okay, we always speak about the four extremes of human emotion. It is the char ras. And none is greater than the other. All is love. All is a ras. And ras, in this meaning, the highest happiness that you could experience as a human being is one out of those four. And you would think that the devotee experiencing God would be higher or more intense than when a vengeful person gets revenge. No. Because it is all rust, it is all love, it is all ecstasy that is given by God. And nothing could happen unless it is sanctioned by God. But does the four rust, even though it is the same height of human emotion that you can experience, so you have four individuals experiencing the four different rusts, and none could be happier than the other, because it is at the extreme point, the top. It cannot be more than the other. Okay? It is love. Love for revenge. Love for money. Love for another human being. Or love for God. You can't go more than that zenith. That point is 100%. You can't go. But my point this morning, does all four take you to the same place? As a human being, we come here to happiness is our natural state, to enjoy life and to be happy. And if you really get to the crux of it, you don't have to do anything to be you. What do you have to do to be you? Nothing, because you're already you. And what do you have to do to be happy? Nothing, because happiness is our natural state. Shivoham, shivoham. That's our natural state. So then, why you become depressed? Why you want to seek revenge? Why you only following money and you give your life up to money? When I was a teenager, I used to always, when I hear the shopkeeper talk about money is not it in life, I say you only saying so because your parents leave you millions, so you ain't care nothing. You don't know what it's to work for money. I used to think so, that they just fooling us because they have all the money in the village and we don't have. I used to think that they didn't know what they're talking about. And when God bless me, and I say, oh, this is what they're talking about. Because money in the bank really doesn't give you happiness. It might give you some comfort. It might give you some kind of other thing. But happiness? No. Happiness is a state that only you can give yourself. So, it has four states of happiness you can give yourself. To be a vengeful person. Always fighting or wishing bad to other people. Only counting the money and checking the bank statement all the time. Or you're only thinking about your lover. Or you're thinking about God. See? In life, I don't expect these young teenagers to be thinking about the fourth one, God. Because in their state of life, yeah, mommy too. In their stage of life, there are certain goals and objectives that you have. That's why we hear the pillars, dharma, earth, kama, moksha. Hinduism is very practical. Young people with their hormones running haywire, and then you have pressures of passing exams, and parents want to pressure you to get to this university. It's not an easy thing. It's not an easy thing. So they would go through the normal processes. But when you reach 75 and 80, then you... See, I shift it up. I shift it up. I would have leave it at 60, but the thing about it is that there are stages in human life. Brahmachari, grihas, vanaprastha, and sannyas. So don't expect the teenager to be thinking sannyas or thinking vanaprastha or grihasthi. No, it is a stage, a normal process that human being evolve into. And then you experience certain things. So sometimes we fool ourselves and think, oh, I want to say Ram, Ram, Ram. What happened to the physics exam? You see, we have to be practical. And Hinduism is a practical religion. It's a way of life. And that's why you cannot assess an 18-year-old with a 35-year-old with a 65-year-old. It cannot be. It cannot be. And that's why in preaching, you have to always remember it is practical. Be realistic. So, you have four types of love you can experience. And sometimes, Jenny, I just want to ask you a question, but don't give me the year. What is the date of birth? 20th. Kabir, what is your date of birth? 8. Right. I just used two examples. You see, we come here, and the time that we enter here, on planet Earth, it is something in relation to when you appeared. So Jenny has an entirely different quality to Kavir. Because Kavir could be very extroverted at a time, whereas Jenny is quite the opposite. Thank you, I got exactly two opposites. Okay? Quite the opposite. So why you would come here, why were you born on the 20th and not on the 21st? Because you had certain past karmas that you had to come here and help your parents to work out in this lifetime. See? So when we want to say, well, why are you only counting money? Jenny used to only count money when she was young. Because she born in the place to count money, but it didn't make her a miser. When you fall in love with money, it's different to when you have money. We have to understand this. When you are a miser, hoarding money, you don't love money. Because you want to put the money. Why we want money? So that we can have a house and a car and a nice sari and a nice sharwal. That's what you have it for. But if you hoard in it, There's an English spell, you have a nice word for it. It coagulate, it clot, it cannot flow, it die, it cannot circulate. That's what it is. So when you fall in one out of these four, it is based on your past karmas that you come here to work out. So we have two extremes, and forgive me, I'm using these two extremes here. We have Kavir playing tabla, and we have Jenny singing. Okay, we have two extremes. And they must never change what they are, but they must aspire to reach a certain goal. They all have love. One love music, one love to cook, one love to help people. We all different. But we come here with certain God-given talents. If we choose one of the four us, it will not take us to the same place. It will not take us to the same place. Because when you think, you experience happiness when the neighbor breaks his foot, you are actually calling a break foot or a breakneck for yourself. See? When you hoard in, you are actually creating hardship for yourself. Even though you have money, you know how much people I know who have all the money in the world and they're not happy. They cannot, so many things that they want in life that they can't do. If money could have buy it, then they would have had it. But it's not possible. It's not true. And if you just stick to loving from a romantic standpoint, you still cannot reach. But why are they equal? Why are they equal? Why we meditate? Science tells us we experience more than 60,000 thoughts rise and fall in our heads every day. And it also goes on to say the sad part about it, it is usually the same 60,000 thoughts. So when you could meditate, if you divide that by the minute, and you could go into meditation 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes each day, you are actually eliminating, because if you either Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, for that period of time, you are eliminating thoughts. So you're actually scraping out some of these wasted thoughts that arise and fall in your head all the time. But when you're in love, no Shiva, all you're thinking is that individual, that individual, that individual. What happens? You have eliminated a lot of thoughts. Sometimes you forget father and mother too.